says you pray for a nation and people will not pray. Eh? The sinners crying out against the government, that's when you see people be active, which is not so good. I want us to read something in 1 Timothy chapter 2. Okay, so 1 Timothy chapter 2. Remember that the Bible says in Corinthians 13, I think it's Romans 13, that we have to obey the government that is above us, because it is God who has put them there to punish evil people and to reward those who behave well. It's God who has put them there, but God has given them a duty to punish those who do wrong things and to reward those who do good things. Now, the question that we ask ourselves is, what then should we do when the government isn't doing what God has called them to do? When now you see the government is instead rewarding evil people and punishing the innocent ones, we would ask that, should Christians fight against the government? What should we do? We have to understand that because we live in a world that is evil, we live in a world that there's no justice. And boy. So we live in a world that there's too many problems, and you and I will be facing issues every day, both against your government and maybe the law officers who are not respecting what God has called them to do, what the government has called them to do. But the question now is, what should I do when I face these difficulties? Should I pray, or should I riot, or should I fight? Or if you in church now, the police people enter here, what should you do? That's the first question we have to ask ourselves. And for us to stay safe in this world, we have to have that answer of what you should do. And if you have to be punished one way or the other, you'll be punished. But the punishment should be for you doing what is right. Are you aware of that? If they have to lock you in prison, it should not be because we're fighting your government. It should be because we're doing something that is right, and then maybe people hated you and so on and so forth. But it says here precisely that pray for what? 1 Timothy chapter 2. What does the first and the second verse say? Let's read it so you stay out of trouble. I urge you first of all to pray for all people. Ask God to help them, intercede on their behalf, and give thanks. Pray this way for kings and all who are in authority, so that they can live peacefully and quiet lives marked by godliness and dignity. This is good and it pleases. What does it say? This is good and it pleases God, that we live in a peaceful environment, in an environment that you don't have to be revenging against the government. You don't have to be in a situation where every day you're fighting, because the Bible has accepted and has said that the justice is crooked, that justice passes from many hands and is twisted and it gets missing in between different authorities. So you can be fighting a just cause, but you never have justice. You should be aware of that, because the rulers of this world, many times they are evil. And the Bible says the love of money is what? Is the root of all evil. And when people see that you're threatening their power and their position, because people have money through power and position, when people feel like you're threatening their positions and their power, you'll be tempted to be a target. Your job as a Christian is to do the work of God, and this is the work of God, that you preach the gospel. That is your business. And if God calls you and gives you a special assignment, like he gave Nehemiah to go and rebuild a city that was broken, he took the necessary permission that he needed from his king and just went and did what he was called to do. Stay away from politics. You understand? Stay away from politics. It's not a game that is meant for Christians. Jesus was killed because they were thinking he was into politics. Paul, the same thing. You know, they killed a lot of innocent children when Jesus was born because the king was afraid that his position would be threatened. The same thing with Moses when he was born. It was the fear that he was born to take over the kingdom that made those children to be killed. The government is not your target. God hasn't sent you and I to be fighting them. Hallelujah. The job you and I are meant to do is to preach the gospel. By the way, this is the end of the month. You remember to give your radio contribution. All of you who like the country to have justice, eh? Fight it by giving your money for the radio so we keep preaching the gospel. If people love God, there will be no evil. True or false? It's a simple question. If people love God, do you think there will be evil? The Bible says the fear of God makes people to stay out of doing bad things. So if in any way you are praying for your nation and you wish that we should live in peace, make sure that you are able to spread God's word to the hearts of people using your money, using your everything. And that is a good fight. Hallelujah. That is a good fight. But don't go out there confronting the government officials and trying to just know your basic rights and live in peace and avoid their wahala. So that your name will not be put on the plate, like as your head, like John the Baptist. And you would live a just cause, and if you die for doing what is right, God will receive the glory. We have been discussing something in Nehemiah, and we will continue with Nehemiah this morning to learn a couple of lessons from the life of Nehemiah that will be a blessing to you and I. And before we go there, I want us to get a word that Jesus said in Matthew chapter 18 verse 22. If you're there, please fastly read for us. Matthew chapter 18 verse 22, when he was talking about forgiveness, Peter rushed up to him and then asked him a question, because he remembered that somewhere Jesus had said that word, that if somebody offends you 7 times in one day and come back for forgiveness, forgive the person. So now Peter rushed up to Jesus and asked him that, Master, Ross's question, the Master, should I forgive my brother up to how many times? Up to 7 times. That's what he asked Jesus. Jesus said, no, 7 times is small. And then he now said that 7 times 70 or 77 times 7. Some versions say 77 times. Another version says 77 times 7. So maybe we use mathematics and so on and so forth. But at the end of the day, if it's 77 times, he says, every day, forgive your brother
77 times.
Then, if it's not 77 times, if you use multiplication, it's 77 times 7. But let's leave it at 77 times in one day. Okay? He says, forgive people who offend you every day 77 times. So each of you hold me 77 times. Forgiveness daily. And each of you owe each other 77 times forgiveness daily. How does that sound?
Nice.
77 times daily. I didn't say you should trust those who hurt you. Forgiveness doesn't mean trust. I've told you that many times. But forgiveness means you forget what they have done to you, but you can take precautions not to be hurt again. But each and every one of you has that responsibility. But that's not what I want to talk about this morning, because we've talked about that a lot. But my question is, if God is giving this rule, that the rule is 77 times, let's assume that, but normally he's talking about unlimited forgiveness. But if God is giving this rule to human beings, what do you think about him himself? Last week we were talking about praying, that when you have an issue, the first person you should rush to is God. That is the first person you should go to. And we would admit that due to the way people behave to us when we go to them for help many times over, we are tempted sometimes not to go again to them. If I come to you today, I beg for transport. Tomorrow I come, I beg for transport. After tomorrow, it will be boring and you will not want to even pick my call. That's human. It's not a sin, okay? Many times it's human and we have those weaknesses. If somebody keeps coming to you for help, how will you feel? Every day the person comes for help and asks for help for one particular thing. They sincerely repent and ask for help and still do the very thing. He stole your money, came back 77 times in one day. Would he forgive that? He did not change the fashion, his one fashion. in one day. Came and told you that the devil's work is two again. Came back and told you that the devil's work is two again. Until your money was finished, they stole somebody's money that they gave you to keep continuously. They reached 77 times. You, the person forgiving, I want you to tell us the truth. After two times, my father used to count one, two, three. At three, he punishes you. Not like he doesn't forgive you, he punishes you at three. There's punishment and consequences to our misbehavior. But now we're focusing, I'm not saying your child disobeys you, not punish them, you have to, but we are focusing on the forgiveness. But if somebody really comes to you repeatedly, it's normal that you behave funny. And since that is what we face daily in our life, that we keep seeing people behave funny towards us because we are asking them for help, sometimes when we go to pray to God, we also feel that that is how God will look at you and I. So that is what scares us now. From rushing to God, immediately we commit the crime. And then we even forget that he has told us that our greatest weaknesses are grounds for his greatest expression of power. He has told us that the places that you're so weak are the places that God will exercise his power the greatest. With all these things he has told us, there's still a tendency that we are afraid to go to God when we have sinned because we think that it is too much, that we have overdone it. So when I look at this scripture, God is giving human beings 77 times or 77 times 7, whatever it may be. I'm asking myself that what is the nature now of the person who is giving? If he is the one, how many times do you think he will forgive you and I in one day? Because some of us go by the day and forget to use all the grace that God has given us for that day. Keep in mind that when we sin, it many times hurts us. If you walk over a broken bottle, the doctor will stitch your leg and it's hurting. But he will stitch your leg. Your mother will pamper you, but it's hurting. You understand? But my point is, what if it happens that you really need to go back to God all the times to ask him to help you? Are you sure you'll be able to go? Yes. In Nehemiah, the Bible says God is describing something in Nehemiah that is so striking. And I want us to read because God answers the prayers of sinners, but sinners who have truly repented. Any sinner who truly repents, God will answer your prayer. When the people of Nineveh, they were so dirty in sin, God wanted to destroy them. When they repented, even the prophet who went to pray was angry. He wanted God to destroy them because their own was bad. But God didn't. When Cain committed the first human sin, murder, God didn't. God forgave him. That was the first human sin. Somebody killed somebody. That is God's nature. And then when the children of Israel, they kept provoking God day after day, night after night, God forgave them. Now in Nehemiah chapter 9, I want us to read from verse 36. I'll read for you while you read it when you get home. He was saying that despite all these, they were disobedient and rebelled against you. They threw your law away. They killed the prophets who encouraged them to return to you, and they committed terrible blasphemies. That is a group of people that I want you to hear their sins. Have you killed any prophet before? Have you killed any prophet before? Just like you see now, the world is bad. They put the head on somebody's neck and the person died. Which I ask you that. There's an old man. What about those children that the mothers, they sat and they were watching how they were cutting their children's head one after the other with cutlass. And they picked the bodies and go and bury. Worst things have happened in this world before when Christians were what? Living. And it was in those times that these things were written to admonish Christians that you have to watch your behavior in the society no matter how evil comes against you. So now he's saying that these people had killed the prophets. So you handed them over to the enemies, but in the time of trouble they cried to you and you heard them from heaven. In great mercy you sent them deliverers who rescued them from their enemies. When the Egyptians were tormenting the Israelites, God sent Moses to rescue them. He says, but when all was going well, like we know, when all is going well in our life, your people tend to sin again. And once more, you let their enemies conquer them. Yet, whenever your people cry to you again for help, you listen once more from heaven. In your wonderful mercy, you rescue them repeatedly. You warn them to return to your law, but they became proud and abstinent and disobeyed your commandments. They did not follow your regulations by which people will find life if only they obey. Now, it's not like God is asking them to obey him because obeying him does them a favor. No, he's asking us to obey him because it gives us good life. You just heard that they don't do good to people because you want to get something from them. God doesn't love us because we can give anything to him. He loves us for our own good, and yet you are calling your child, come and eat pizza, and the child decides to go and be eating food from trash. That's what happens. The reason God is asking us to come to him is not because we do him any favor. It's because it is good life he wants to give us. They stubbornly turn their backs on you and refuse to listen. Now, one group of people are these that no matter how good you do to them, they still don't like you. Have you had such people in your life? You have no evil against them. Anytime they think about you, they think about what you are not thinking. And they even force thoughts into your behavior and explain your actions. Why are you laughing? And explain your actions in ways that you have not even done anything. There are people like that. These are behaving to God. God, there's some of them saw the Red Sea as God divided the Red Sea, they passed through, and after they see, ask God that, hey, what is wrong with you? Don't you know that we are hungry? They had no mannerism in talking to God. How can you have hands, have legs, and you're saying that you're hungry? Is it God to come and cook for you? And here, verse 30, in your love, you were patient with them for many years. It's not many days. It's not many months. It's not from morning to evening. Since morning, I've been hoping that you come and tell me I'm sorry you did not come. The evening, they close your forgiveness page. You have been patient with them for many years. You send your spirit through the prophets to warn them about their sins, but they still wouldn't listen. So once again, you allow the pagans to inhabit your land and conquer them. But in your great mercy, you did not destroy them completely or abandon them forever. That is gracious and merciful of you, Lord. God is gracious and merciful. Psalmist will say in many places that your unfailing love, your unfailing love, your endless love, your love that never ends. God forgives you and buries your sins beneath the depths of the river that even sea divers cannot see. If he is asking you to forgive your neighbor 77 times, when he forgives you, they wipe your database of criminal record. That is the God. And if you are aware that that is the God, you have enormous times to ask him when you have a problem without thinking that your sins are always there looking against you. Because it is the simple reason why we are unable to pray to God sometimes, because we feel that our sins have become so heavy that it has separated us from God and we cannot reach him. But that is the job Jesus has done, to come and carry those sins and nail them on the cross. So there is never a day your sin will become so big to separate you from God that you can't reach him to ask him for help. The problem is just that you have to turn and ask him for help. Because when we keep sinning, we are turned into the consequences of our sins that torments our life every day. But when we turn to God, he is always there. The Bible says he will not reject anyone who comes to him. Why can't you go to God when you are in problems? Why do you need 3-day, 5-day fasting to cleanse yourself, to feel worthy to talk to God? By the time you're done with the 3-4 days, 5-day fasting, something worse has really happened. He has told you that
He knows your thought before you talk to him. So why would you need to write a novel, edit the novel, put it in all kinds of languages before taking your prayers to God? Somebody who knows what you're thinking before you come to talk to him. Why is it difficult for us to express our greatest weakness to God? Why? If you search yourself, the simple reason is this behavior of people who reject you because you have over-asked them for help torments you and I, and make us to think that God is man. Psalmist tells us that, how could you ever think that God is like human beings? God is not like human beings. No matter how many times these people offended him, his unfailing love was always there for them. And at this time, he had not even sent Jesus. Now he has sent Jesus. What do you think about the unfailing love of God over your life? Because when we will get to heaven, most of us will be amazed at how much love of God, how much grace of God that we didn't use when we had to use while we were on earth. Because we thought, as we are living in a world of limited resources, as we are living in a world that when you commit a crime, they give you life sentence, we have also thought that that is how our God is. That is not how he is. He is a God of endless forgiveness. He is a God of unfailing love. His mercies does what? Endure it forever. Don't you have Bible students here? His mercies endure it forever. I'm saying this to you because we have to pray to God for the problems we face. God is even asking you to pray for your nation. We complain about our nations, but we never pray. You'll be asking yourself, can prayer work for these people? Prayer works for everybody. Because you pray to a sovereign God, so prayer works for everybody. As long as you put everything into the hands of God, there will always be an answer. Even today, Jesus is still sitting before God, praying for you and I, and God is answering. And it is Jesus who has told you and I that we must pray to him, and he will answer us. Prayer changes things. Hallelujah. Prayer can turn things around that you would never imagine. But you just have to. When he went to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah with fire, he was asking Abraham, do you have people inside there who can turn and say they are sorry? Yes, sins were crazy. They were wise sinners. But God was asking them, Abraham, I will forgive them. But do you have the people? Nobody was ready to ask for forgiveness. But as long, keep that one in your head. You have 77 times to forgive somebody every day. How many does God have for you? He's the one who has given that rule. So you're asking that God, now, you say I should forgive Thomas 77 times a day. You, God, I'm asking you, how many times do you forgive me in one day? So mommy Constance has to forgive Brother Philip, because his sins against her has not reached 10 since I started counting. So she has a long way to go with him. And forgiving him, I've forgotten. That's why I don't worry again. And I don't have a heart attack. Because he's abusive, he's actually quite a friend. Pressing spoil button. But that is how you approach God. God, you have given me a commandment and I'm obeying it. I'm trying to obey. So God, attention. If me, I'm trying to forgive somebody even 10 times in one day and I'm still, you have to forgive me, auntie. And he doesn't have a problem. That is just a problem. Somebody says somebody's problem because the person does not know his problem. God doesn't have a problem forgiving you, no matter what you have done. You should be able to love him and live with that love. Somebody say, Pastor, please, it's because of my work, I'm not able to make it to church, but I'll try because I work at night. And maybe because the person has not been to church for so many Sundays, the person really feels that the many Sundays counting is so heavy. So for him to receive forgiveness for all of those, no. As you just realize yourself like a prodigal son, no way, and start eating the pig's food before you go to your father. As the last food is finishing on the table, even before it finishes, go back. Just go, just before the last grace is finishing, which cannot finish, just hurry and go back. Don't wait for things to be tough And all the native doctors are taking everything you have. Then you start going to Jesus like the woman with the issue of blood. No. They will still forgive you, but the doctors have taken everything you have. When God forgives you, you have to go and start hustling again from scratch. Don't allow sin to completely destroy your life or the consequences of your mistakes and errors to completely pull you down before you think of going to God. Hallelujah. Immediately it signals in your head. Turn to God. Hallelujah. Because he has asked you that forgive people what? And so he is owing you more than that. And he has the capacity to do that. We ought to serve God with this confidence. We have to serve God with this no fear, you know, this harmony. You just feel cool serving God. You don't keep approaching God like he has not yet reached that level. When this law is destroyed, that's when we'll see the anger of God. Now, it is not existing, so just enjoy it. Don't allow sin to rob you of all your blessings. I was asking somebody that, is your father cursed? Your father is supposed to have excess wealth now. And they told me that, no, that man cannot be cursed because he has multiple streams of income. I said, no, curse means you have multiple streams of income, but you're carrying them in a basket. Like you have multiple streams of water carrying, passing in a basket. So you can be so blessed by God, but you allow sin and the consequences of sin to just be opening roads through which the blessings are flowing out of your life. But it's your job and my job to always rush to God, ask for forgiveness. He delivers us from the consequences of our sins and wipes that record off, delivers us from our guilt, and we keep living and going until we become, you'll be only perfect when you meet Jesus. That is what you should understand. So we keep walking in Christianity and going gradually until we finally meet Jesus. My encouragement for you, I didn't come here to tell you today to forgive people because you know you have to forgive people. But my encouragement for you is that God owes you much more forgiveness than what you owe each other. And he has already opened the door to forgive you at any time you rush to him. So if you are in any form of difficulties, think of God first. If you're in difficulties with your government officials, think of God first. That's what you should do. Think of God first. I love this man named, I just love him for the way he was acting. All of his things were with God. If God told him, go and do this thing, when he goes and he's doing it, if you are mocking at him, he doesn't have a business with you. He's just focused on doing what God has called him to do. And he was a successful person in his time. We also, because I don't know what God has called you to do. God might have called you to give justice to a group of people who are suffering. You understand? That is the gospel. God can call you to give justice to a group of people who are suffering. You have to do it wisely, asking for God's approval. If you have chosen to become a lawyer like some of us have chosen to become, it's not like you don't have things to do in the society. You have. But you have to make sure that you do it in a way that God is backing you. If not, this wicked world that you live inside, they will not leave you to rest. They say when Nehemiah came back to rebuild the wall, a group of people were not happy. Because they knew that in that suffering, they were enjoying. Anywhere there is suffering, some people are enjoying. They are aware of that. So if you are going to deliver certain people who are suffering from oppression, the Bible says we should fight justice for the poor, we should fight justice for those who don't have money. Know that some people are enjoying because those people are under suppression. So you cannot go with your own power alone. No. Ask God what to do. Keep human wisdom because the highest of human wisdom is still foolishness to God. So let's die to human wisdom and use God's wisdom, and we will succeed in this world no matter how wicked it is. God first. God first. The minimum things and to the maximum things, my prayer for you is who? God first. Talent, whatever you want to do, whatever you want to do in this world, my prayer for you is God first. When you talk to God and you're vigilant, you have a successful life. And don't be so crazy about money. Money is not the only problem in this world. It's one of the many problems in this world. We have just made it the only problem. I did something for somebody, the person said, Pastor, when I'm rich, I'll not forget you. I look at the person, you're healthy, you have a job, and you're telling me when you're rich. I said, what do you define as when you're rich? There is mental poverty, and that is what many people suffer from. Let me explain to you mental poverty. You have 1,000, you are not eating, put airtime for 1,000 and chat and laugh and sleep hungry. It's mental poverty. You build a house of millions and your house girl is taking care of your children's salary is 50,000 and it's an illiterate. It's mental what? Poverty. You build a house to show people that, wow, I have a beautiful house. But they come inside the house, people inside the house are living in rags. They can't have a balanced diet where you can buy wine for hundreds of thousands and you eat food when nobody is seeing you. Popo and beans, not because you want popo and beans, but because the balance of your body after the night was 200 francs. After you have given some poor transport of 50, 20, 30,000, now you eat popo and beans. It's called mental poverty. You understand? You now buy a car for millions and look for a frustrated driver and be suffering him, be suppressing him to drive a car of millions. Or go and jam the car. You understand? If I'm the driver, I'll go and jam the car. It's, you know, this rich man that when he's eating, he's not giving it to the driver. So when he's trying to drink, the driver will just enter a pothole. And the juice will go on his body. Because the person you are entrusting your life to is not happy with you. You are doing other things with money, but the people who are working directly under you, who are serving, who take care of your children, you are maltreating them. And you're outside there pouring money to other people. It's called what? Mental poverty. Mental disorder. And you'll never be rich. You know about having money. You'll never be rich because that's how you always be. So some people say you want to be rich. If you have food to eat, dress to wear, and somewhere to sleep, and you love God, biblically, it's wealth. You understand? So while you are striving for more, don't become stupid. By sacrificing your happiness today, thinking that when you become rich, things will be better. What do you mean by things will be better? The more wealth you have, the more people come to eat. It's just like tax. The more money you have, the more tax you pay. Hallelujah. That is what you should understand. God has blessed you. Compose yourself. Live a happy life. Stay away from government problem. Because if they owe you, you really confess. They held poor for 2 years, waiting for him to give bread. He didn't give. He stayed there for 2 years. But God was saying he didn't have time. He was then writing his books. But please, when you have issues, before you go and be asking your friends who don't have sense, ask God first. Because some of your friends will give you wrong advice because they admire what you have and want you to lose it. Ask God first. And then God will direct your steps. He says, call on me, I'll answer. I'm the closest help you have in times of trouble. He's everything you need at every point in time in your life. Call God first.